Good afternoon. My name is Deb Arnes, and I'm the Senior Museum Curator for the Nebraska State Historical Society, and I'd like to welcome you to the Museum of Nebraska History and our Brown Bag Lecture Series. Before I introduce today's speaker, I'd like to thank the Nebraska State Historical Society Foundation for funding the filming of these Brown Bag Lectures. Today's presentation is entitled Emery Blagdon and His Healing Machines and is a tie-in to our current exhibit, Weird Nebraska, Strange Stories and Amazing Facts, which features a number of pieces of Emery's work and will be on display until the end of this year. Today's speaker is Dan Dryden, who 30 years ago was working as a pharmacist in North Platte when Emery Blagdon walked in asking for some elements. Little did Dan know how significant this seemingly insignificant event would be to his life and to the larger art world, and he's here today to tell us about that meeting, his subsequent acquisition of the entire collection of this now world-famous outsider artist, and the ongoing efforts to preserve his body of work. So please join me in welcoming Dan Dryden.
Hi, thanks, Deb, and welcome everybody. I'm going to tell you about Emery Blagdon walking into my drugstore in 1975, and he looked pretty much like this when he walked in. I thought he was a bum, really. He looked like he had just come off the railroad, but he came into the store looking very confident. He had a very nice smile. He had an attitude about him that didn't suggest anything but a goal that he had, and his goal was to acquire elements for his work. He asked me for elements. I said, there's a lot of elements. What elements would you like? And he tried to define his request, and he eventually came up with earth elements after describing a little bit about his healing machines and how they had energy fields around them, and so I was fairly confident that he wanted mineral salts because they have magnetic properties. They're compounds that have a positive and a negative element to them. So he was very sweet, and I actually liked him right away when we started talking, and he was so earnest and direct in his inquiry that I was pleased to be able to bottle up some mineral salts and give them to him. And I was so curious about what he was up to that I asked if I could come and see them, which he said yes, of course. So I did that, and I went there one evening after work, and it was after dusk. And I went out there. The place looked abandoned. And he showed me his healing machines. And I've never seen anything like it before or since. He opened up a little shed in the back of his farmyard and flicked a switch. And from the blackest night came all these colored lights and tinfoil and a mass of color, and it was just amazing. So that was my first introduction. He grabbed my wrist and dragged it next to a piece and said, do you feel the energy field? And I said, well, I tried to be, you know, accommodate him, but I don't think I was very, I don't think he believed me, but anyway. And then he went to the next one. He said, each one is different. So then I understood that he was working on his pieces in order to make a variable field of energy. He worked up in the northeast corner of Lincoln County. You can see the big yellow area up here where the sand hills are, and then this little spit of brown sticking out there just in the northeast corner of Lincoln County. That's the Garfield table. And it's a, it is not the Sand Hills, as I've been told by local residents. It's the Garfield table instead. So I made that mistake at first in describing where Emery lived, and I was corrected. And so he worked up there and lived up there for most of his life. He was born in 1907 in Callaway, and the family moved up to Lincoln County shortly thereafter. And they all had farms up there. The landscape looks something like this, for those of you that haven't been out that way. And there was a large family. There was six kids and some other brothers and sisters of the father, I think, and they all had farms up there. This is Emery's family, as it looked probably. Emery's the tall one in the center there. I imagine he was in his teens, probably, at that point. He had been to school through the eighth grade, I think, and then dropped out and helped with the family farm. At some point, he went on the road and became a hobo. I think it was probably, I would say, in the late 20s and 30s, probably during the Depression. Even his own family weren't really clear on these dates, but he would come and go for a period of years. And when he finally returned to Lincoln County, he moved in with his bachelor uncle, who then died and left him a farmstead of about 160 acres. And he ended up with this house, which this picture was taken when I met him in 1975. Or, well, it might have been taken later, but it looked the same as it did in 75. Anyway, he wasn't big on housekeeping, I think. But he lived there, and so you can imagine when I drove up to this house and it looked like it looks, that I was not sure I was in the right place. But he took me out to his shed, which was this shed. This shed is about, the front room there is about, oh, maybe 10 by 10 feet, and the back section is 20 by 24. And it was arranged in a way, you'll excuse the artwork, but the small one is section there is the outer room, which he used as a workshop and had works in progress. The inner space was his main display area. Those, the yellow are planks around, it's a walkway basically around, and so he had a lot of flatter pieces lining the walls, and in the center was freestanding and hanging circular pieces mostly. So walking through the front door there, you saw something like that. And you're seeing not the front room at all, really, just a bit on the sides. And then walking through, you can see the main center section and a few of the floorboards. Here's a closer view of that center section. Notice on the lower part of the picture towards the right, there's a couple of paintings. You can't see them very well, but he had a total of around 100 paintings that were kind of stashed in amongst these sculptures. And actually, I didn't know there was any paintings at all in the collection at the time that I saw this for the first time. It was too overwhelming for me to understand what components there were. But later, when I acquired the work then and began to look through it, it became obvious that there was paintings there. Now, turning to the left, just inside the door, this is a wall would be the north wall. I'm going to take you around the shed clockwise. So these are flat pieces layered sometimes 4, 6, 8 pieces thick. Now I should explain what a piece is, and I didn't know that until I got possession of the work. And it turned out that there was nails in the walls, and each nail had a wire loop on it, or more than one or two or three. And it turned out, luckily, that each wire loop would come off, and then whatever was attached to that got a number, and it was called a piece. So it turned out to be quite modular. And the way that Blagdon worked was that he experimented with the placement of these things constantly, and so that the work was modular in a way. So then turning right, that's, you can see a bit of the center section on the right, and now that's another view down the north wall and looking at a corner of the east wall. Now the east wall has these big square pieces that were made with mostly lath from a house demolition, I suppose, with bits of foil tacked on them. There's another view, more or less of the same thing, a little bit closer. This is more of a detail of that back wall with the lath pieces. You can see the paintings sort of tucked in behind things there, behind the sculpture pieces. And you can see the Ford tail light on the right there. It worked. It had a little Christmas tree light in it, and it came on along with the rest of the lights. You'll see a lot of cables dangling around there, and he had the whole place wired, and it's a miracle that it didn't burn down, because it wasn't, you know, some of the splices are with masking tape, and it was a mess. Here now we're looking down the south wall, and on the right-hand side you can see just about a third of a big hanging chandelier that I call the giant chandelier. And here's a little bit closer or different view of that. That's the biggest piece in the collection on the right, and that piece is about 36 inches in diameter and 7 feet tall. On the floorboards, I discovered after acquiring the work that the these designs were painted on the floorboard face down. So there was some kind of, also the paintings, you may have noticed, were mostly on the ground, and that had something to do, I think, with the way his energy system worked. Underneath the dirt floor, 2 inches, was a wire grid about 6 inches square. So he had this whole system worked out. I did try to look around the hobo dictionary in different places to see if those markings meant anything, and I couldn't find any reference to them. I'm going to go through now a little bit of close-ups of the center and different pieces, so I won't explain these directly, but instead I'll describe the acquisition of the work and the subsequent efforts to preserve it. In 1986, I visited North Platte and with my childhood friend Don Christensen, and I was very interested in showing Don this work. And so we drove out there in the summer of 86. I hadn't seen Blagdon or been in contact with him for 12 years, and hadn't, in fact, been back to North Platte in that amount of time. We drove up there and found that Blagdon had passed away from cancer at the age of 78, about 6 weeks earlier. He had not left a will. All his possessions were in probate and up for auction about 3 weeks later. So, strangely enough, after all this time, I managed to drop into this situation at a critical moment, and I attended the auction with Don, and we bought the entire body of work at that time, not really knowing what we were getting into. A couple weeks later, we started getting in there and, you know, taking these pictures and trying to see how we would document things. Don's brother, Dan Christensen, came out with us, and a couple other people helped out, and we figured out how to document the work before disassembling the shed. So we photographed the scene, and then I told you about the loops in the wire. We made numbered tags, and we one of the people, his job was just to sit there with a sketch pad and map the shed. So we had numbers and we put them on the hooks, on the loops, and took the loops off the nails, and they were mapped, and then we carried them into North Platte and warehoused them. Once they were in North Platte in the warehouse, we took each piece and photographed it individually. And then we had a catalog of the work. After that, we were faced with the problem of how to make the work known to the outside world. And I didn't know anything about outsider art at the time, and not really much about conservation or preservation of art or anything like that. So I started making some phone calls, and I was met with responses that varied from skepticism to disinterest. And until I talked to a woman named Linda Roscoe Hartigan. At the time, she was an assistant curator at the Museum of American Art, a division of the Smithsonian in D.C. They had just acquired a big visionary art work called the Hampton Throne, which was a big tinfoil construction in somebody's garage. And so she knew exactly what I was talking about and was very excited about it. She hooked me up with the Mid-America Arts Alliance in Kansas City, which was a consortium of several states, including Nebraska, that produces visual art, performing arts, and various cultural projects that tour. So we picked 60 pieces that were relatively robust. Some of the work, especially the work with a lot of foil, we didn't know how to package and move that. But in doing some research with the Smithsonian in terms of how they crated pieces and so forth, we designed a crating system that the flatter pieces were in trays, and the bigger round pieces were packed in their own compartments or own crates. And we toured that, and we had a number of shows. It was at UNO, it was in Scotts Bluff, it was in North Platte, it was in Wichita, Atlanta, Tucson. So it did well, Lawrence, Kansas. So there was, it began at that point then to be more widely known. I just want to point out this slide. This is the exposure is not great, but this is the giant chandelier. And below the giant chandelier is a like a pickle jar with a light bulb in it, and the light bulb was hand painted and it had some other pieces of metal and stuff in it, sitting on top of a stack of several paintings. So he had this, there was obviously an energy flow scheme that Blagdon had in mind, and a very particular way of displaying the work. After the Mid-America Arts Alliance exhibit kind of ended, all along I had been doing research into who was interested in this kind of work and different organizations, and I ended up with a contact in the Jean Dubuffet Collection, Collection de l'Art Brut, which is Dubuffet collected this work in, I believe, in the 20s mostly, and it was asylum art in Europe, in inmates are doing therapeutic art, I guess you might call it, and he collected this stuff, called it Art Brut, raw art, and there was a museum of that work in Lausanne, Switzerland, still is. And through that connection, information on Blagdon's work ended up in the hands of a very famous curator called Harold Zeman. He was a Swiss curator that had a big practice in Europe and was very well known for his sort of maverick ideas about art exhibits. He included, he actually commissioned a reconstruction of Blagdon's, of this shed, built a set for it, built a shed, he called it the hut, and put it in the Lyon Biennale in 1998, I believe. This was along with work by modern contemporary artists, not outsider or visionary artists, and it was really great to have this work not be categorized as some particular kind of art. Instead, it was included with a broad variety of artists. And it was very successful. Subsequently, that exhibit came back and was included in a similar group show at the Philadelphia Museum of Art in 2000. A curator named Elsa Longhauser, who was working in Philadelphia at the time, partnered up with Harold Zeman to produce that show. So one of my original goals to recreate the entirety of Blagdon's main exhibit had at that point been realized. This is a photo of that exhibit. We had 75 crates of work weighing probably 4 tons. It filled a tractor trailer, and it went by sea to France, making me extremely nervous. But it made it. So there and back. It was a lot of fun to do that. But we only were going to do it a very limited amount of time because the work, it had never traveled from Blagdon's shed, and of course then we hauled it into North Platte, and you know, carted it around the world a little bit, and that was enough. You know, it was not extremely happy to be doing that. It required a bit of conservation to keep it in shape. This series of slides I'm going to show you now is taken by a fellow from Lawrence, Kansas, named John Blum, and he belongs to the Kansas Grassroots Art Association in Lawrence, and they are preservationists and conservationists of outsider and visionary art, and they were one of the early supporters of Blagdon's work, and they came to the warehouse in North Platte, and a few of those folks, and we did some studio shots of this work. These first few are, I'm going to show you the piece of work and then some detail shots, so you can kind of zoom in on the works a little bit. Meanwhile, a woman named Lisa Stone, who is a lecturer at the Art Institute in Chicago, had also been a big supporter of Blagdon from the beginning, and she gave us a connection to the Kohler Foundation in Kohler, Wisconsin. And the Kohler Foundation is famous for its involvement in outsider and visionary artists. They have they bought a house of a visionary artist called the Rhinestone Cowboy in the South, and they moved the house to their museum and reconstructed it. So this was right up their alley. And so after these reconstructions, Kohler Foundation did express some interest in conserving, acquiring and conserving the Blagdon work. And about 3 years ago, they did in fact acquire that work and are now in the process of conserving it. And I think in the fall of 2007, they will be mounting an exhibit similar to our reconstruction. The exhibit is not designed yet. I don't know exactly what it's going to be, but I'm sure it'll be great. This is the inside of this lath box. I'm just going to go through some of the paintings because they're so great. His style is obvious, even though they don't really have a lot of similarity on the face of it. But it's beautiful work. Most of these paintings are on wood, and he used little bottles of Tester's model enamel. A great choice of medium, actually. The wood degrades far less quickly than canvas, and the enamel is good. So that was a good medium choice for him. His worst medium choice was masking tape. Very tough stuff. There's one piece there's more than one piece that's metal cores wrapped over and over and over with masking tape. Here's some pieces that won't have details, but just to take you through some of the different forms that he used. That piece is gigantic. It's 30 inches in diameter and about 36 high. The cone at the bottom is so dense you can hardly see through it. It's just layer after layer, In my interviews with his siblings, I asked if they could tell me anything about how he worked. And one of his sisters said she thought probably from the inside out. That seemed reasonable to me. This piece is also about 36 inches long and a foot in diameter. There's one of the masking tape examples. This is one of the few pieces that has any kind of representational image. The thing sticking out of the top is an automobile antenna that actually you can pull out and push back if you wish. So I think at this point, I would be confident to say that Blagdon is well on his way to making an impression as a Nebraska artist. I think he'll probably come down as one of the more well-known Nebraska artists, and I think he deserves to be. And I'm happy that I could have a part in saving his work. As for future news, the Kohler Art Center is in Sheboygan, Wisconsin, and if you want to check their website about exhibit schedules and news and so forth about Blagdon, they have a website. And that's about all I have to say formally, but I'm happy to entertain questions if anyone has any.
There was
no bidders. Nobody was interested in dealing with this stuff.
And then also, I was going to ask if you had any idea how many years he was involved in this.
Yes. I think he started in 1954, roughly, when he had acquired. He was a farmer. He was helping with the family farms up until that time. I think he was probably about 48 years old. And with no prior artistic output at all, he had inherited this land from his uncle. And he had his brother, Ed, help him build this shed and quit farming and did this for 30 years. And if you divide the number of pieces by 30 years, it comes out to one piece every 2 weeks or so. Yes?
Did he call it the healing machine?
He did. Yeah, he indeed did.
How did he mean that?
How did he mean the healing machines? It was a, he had this idea that he was manipulating energy fields, that being close up to these works had a beneficial effect by virtue of the fact that they did have energy fields. Now, I should say that before dismantling the shed, I took a voltmeter out there and I drove a ground stake outside the shed, 8-foot copper ground stake, and hooked one end of the meter to that, took the meter and the other lead inside, and I, in fact, did find voltages on those machines. And in one in particular, let me see if I can show you this. I found a, well, maybe I can't find it anymore, but a voltage of between 1 and 10 volts that was oscillating. Yeah, at about one cycle per second. So most of it, I feel, was induction by all the electrical cables he had in there, rather than something that came out from the earth. Although I did visit him once again, and I found him out in his field with a lot of planks laid out, and he was kind of, I won't say dancing, but he was kind of whirling around in the field, and said he had tapped into an energy vein. So I don't know how he felt that he was harnessing this, but that's the idea. Yes.
How many total units or pieces were there?
Well, it depends on how you count. I mean, there's pieces that we took from his trash pile, you know, but I would say nominally around 550, including the 100 paintings. Yes.
Sorry. 76.
Yes.
Did he give any indication, his family give any indication? Was he ill? Was he trying to cure himself of something? Was this a?
That's a great question. Was he trying to heal himself?
Yeah, was it
yes.
Overall spiritual, or was it more like he was?
I think it was a practical matter. He lost two siblings and his mother and father early to cancer. So I'm quite sure there was a practical motivation there. I don't know where he got the idea or how he managed to get to this point, but of deciding how to deal with it, but yes. The latter. Certainly he saw them as functional and aesthetic. He was very proud of the work. He loved showing it off. He had it displayed, as you can see, in a very, it was a showy display. He was clearly had a foot on both sides of the line. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
On behalf of Emery's family, I'd like to say thank you. I'm Edna's granddaughter, it is very nice to see it, at the Kohler Foundation and all the work that's been done to preserve that. I know my grandmother was very intent on having it being preserved. He wanted people to see it. He called it his pretties, if you want
yes,
to see. He called it my pretties. If you'd like to see my pretties, you can come to the shed. And I had the privilege of growing up a half mile from there and spending almost every day watching him put it together. So it's just, it's amazing. And yes, he did feel like it had a healing power because he was a very sensitive, emotional person, and he really felt like he could help people by creating this healing machine to cure, arthritis, cancer. He was truly looking for a way to help them.
I think we have to say that although he did try to help people, he never portrayed himself as a healer or a practitioner of any sort.
No, but he truly wanted to help people, and
yes.
He wanted to make them feel better, whether it was with a smile or a kind gesture or taking them on a walk through his shed. And his shed was actually built out of the barn. He and his brother Edward tore it down specifically to build the shed.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of other things. The house painted. He did have it painted once, and someone took advantage of him. They thinned the paint with diesel, and as he had it painted, and he never had it painted again. He was so devastated that they took advantage of him that they never had the house repainted. It's just amazing to see the work again. The beaded chandelier that you showed was from my grandma's beads that she made necklaces out in the late 70s.
Uh-huh.
And he actually incorporated those leftover beads then from beads that my grandma made necklaces out of when they were real popular, that they hung down and you could fold them over. My grandma crocheted those. The paint from the models came from my brother's models and paint by numbers that we used at home. So,
right.
Yeah. But anyway, it's very interesting to see the process.
Yes, sir.
I'm curious as to what he lived on for an income all of those years he was in the shed.
Well, I believe he once he inherited the land, he leased it and lived off the income plus his garden and family contributions of different things.
He leased it, and then my his niece's husband then afterwards farmed the land, and then he was like a sharecrop type thing. He also had three gardens. He grew all of his own food. He baked all of his own bread up until the time that he became ill with his cancer. He canned his own fruit and vegetables. You know, he never bought bread from the store. He always baked it from scratch, and he made cakes and all kinds of stuff. It was very interesting. One of the other things that you don't see is, you know, he loved to look at things under the microscope, and he had on his kitchen table, there were tons of experiments that he had gotten a chemistry set from the biology teacher at the school, and he had all different kinds of plant materials. He put some of the elements that he got from Mr. Dryden, as well as some that came in the chemistry set that we had to kind of limit because he was...
He also used soil and
all kinds of earth things.
Yeah.
And he looked at those under the microscope to see how those then reacted against each other. And he spent a lot of time looking at his microscope. He really enjoyed that, mm-hmm. and showing it to you.
Anyone else in the family have artistic leanings or...
Not of that nature.
That nature was pretty unique.
It was very unique.
Yes, sir.
Was his work known by anyone prior to your introduction to
not
open to the public?
Well,
at any point in time?
KNOP-TV, the local NBC affiliate out there, had done a piece on him, you know, but only like a 30-second news spot. Nothing in depth. I don't think he was well known to the world at large, no. Even some of his neighbors apparently didn't know what he was doing. Some did and hung out and were friends with Emery, but there was others that had no idea. The work was indoors, so it wasn't really obvious to the casual observer. Yes, sir.
Did he retain everything he produced? Did you, any idea that he ever gave away or tried to sell?
As far as I know, he retained everything.
He didn't even give a piece to family. It was all part of the machine.
Yeah, it would be like giving away your carburetor out of your car or something. I mean, there's no real reason to do that. Tom.
I'm curious, and this might be a question for either one of you. You mentioned, you talked about the sort of the modular characteristics of the whole thing, but how often would he sort of experiment with moving pieces around? Would that become an integral part of his experimentation with it?
I think so.
Every day.
I think it was an ongoing process. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, what we saw in 1986 was the last snapshot.
Sure, right. Otherwise, it was kind of a moving picture.
Yeah.
Always changing.
Yeah.
Energy field was. He also buried bottles out in the pasture to direct the energy. I know you talked about the things that he had on the display, but it took us, you know, we couldn't use the pasture again then until after those, because they were only buried about halfway up, and they were actually directional towards the shed, and they were filled with elements and all kinds of different things to direct that energy from out there in. So those aren't there anymore, but at one point that was very instrumental in how his energy field was set up.
Sure.
So it was conceived as a single healing machine?
Exactly.
And then was it
with
the
parts.
The pieces that are out here, they actually belong to the machine?
There was an exterior room that was a workroom, and the pieces that aren't in the Kohler Foundation are mostly those.
He also painted in the house.
Hmm?
He also painted in the house.
Yeah, the ceiling in his kitchen had concentric rings painted in metallic colors.
And horseshoes play a very integral part of his design. He always kept one above the doorway between the kitchen and the living room. And in the walkway,
oh.
So,
always
up.
So Dan, there were miles and miles of wire that these are made out of? And
yeah, well, his main medium was baler wire, which was a very fortunate medium, actually, because it's oiled. And so it's actually held up very well in terms of corrosion. Yeah, and the copper, I think he mostly bought old tools and so forth and unwound the armatures from electric motors. And that wire is coated with plastic. So mostly he chose his media very well. Fortunately for us, for all of us. All right, well, thank you.